Let's say you're working in Unreal Editor and it crashes. What do you do? What do you need to know? Well, first of all, an editor crash could be the result of problems in your game code, or it could be a legitimate engine bug, or it could be somewhere in the middle. So don't yell at the programmers on your team because it could be an engine problem. And don't yell at Epic because it could be a problem with your project. And before you yell at anybody, chill out and don't yell at people. Nobody needs to be getting emotional about software. Despite all the complexities involved, a computer is just a machine that does exactly what you tell it to do. And if something's going sideways, there's always an identifiable cause. The better you come to understand that fact, the easier it'll be to deal with bugs. So, when you run into a crash, ultimately you want to find a fix or a workaround, which requires knowing why the problem is happening. Maybe investigating and fixing bugs is part of your job description, or maybe you just need to report the problem to a programmer on your team and get back to work. Either way, you'll want to start by answering a few questions. First, what is happening? That is, can you describe what you see, and is there an error message? Then, where in the program does it happen, or is there a call stack? And when does it happen? In other words, what conditions lead to the crash, and does it happen consistently? And who does it happen to? Is it affecting other people or just you? All of that information will ultimately help you or someone else answer the most critical question, why is it happening? So for the first question, what's happening? A bug report that amounts to "it crashes" is very hard to do anything with, so we want to answer this question as precisely as possible. In the case of this bug, the editor freezes for a second, then it shuts itself down, and we get a crash reporter window. The crash reporter shows us an error message and a call stack. The error message is helpful, but it doesn't always tell the full story. In this case, an access violation reading address 0 means that our code is wound up trying to dereference a null pointer. That's good to know, but it doesn't tell us where that null pointer read is happening. That's where the call stack comes in. The call stack tells us what part of the program was being executed when the error occurred, along with the chain of function calls that led to that point. If you're responsible for investigating the bug, this tells you where to start. If you're reporting the error to somebody else, don't just tell them, "I got a crash." You want to tell them, "I got a crash and here's the call stack." It can also be useful to have a full log file, and in the event of a crash, the error and call stack will be included at the tail end of the log file. Unreal automatically writes log files for both the editor and for standalone game instances to your project's saved logs directory. The most recent file will always be projectname.log, and older files will have a timestamp appended. As a quick aside, if you install the engine through the Epic Games launcher, you may find that your call stacks are missing information for crashes involving engine code. This means you don't have debugging symbols or PDB files for the engine. If you modify your engine installation through the launcher, you can download these debugging symbols. These aren't included by default because they take up about 30 gigs, but they're essential if we want to have any useful diagnostic information about the engine itself. Why do we need PDB files? Well, when you run the editor, it loads a bunch of DLL files containing the compiled binaries for a bunch of engine modules. If your project has C++ source modules, those are loaded as well. Even if you have the original source files that these DLLs were compiled from, there's no link between them. Where we have a nice, human-readable C++ function in the source file, the corresponding function in the compiled binary is just a series of processor instructions that are located at some memory address. We can figure out that the editor is executing the function located at this address, but without symbol files, we have no clear way of knowing what actual C++ function that is. So PDB files are essentially a paper trail that leads from the compiled binaries back to the corresponding source files. If we have the PDB files for these DLLs, then diagnostic tools like the crash reporter can figure out exactly which functions are being called, which is kind of important if we want a useful call stack. So the error message and the call stack tell us what's happening and where, and the log file is good to have for context. The next most important question is when the problem happens. That is, what conditions lead to the crash? What were we doing when the crash happened, and what do we have to do to make it happen again? This crash happens when we start a play and editor session and then press the eject button. If we test a bit more, we might notice that the eject button works fine if we wait a few seconds after starting the game. There's a brief moment where the viewport is black, and the crash only occurs if we eject during that time. Our play and editor settings are currently configured to run a multiplayer session with a dedicated server. If we switch to single player, we'll notice that there's no black screen and we can't provoke the crash. So a little bit of quick experimentation has helped us come up with a more precise description of how to reproduce the problem. Instead of, "the editor sometimes crashes when I eject from play an editor," we can now confidently say, "the editor always crashes if I eject from a multiplayer play an editor session within the first second or two." In most cases, it's possible to come up with repro steps that will reliably trigger the problem. But some issues really are sporadic, which makes them harder to track down and fix. So it can be helpful to identify whether a problem happens 100% of the time. Depending on the bug, it might also be useful to ask around and see if anybody else is seeing the same issue. That can help to confirm that it's a legitimate bug, as opposed to being an issue with your workspace or with how your system is configured. So at this point, we have the essential information to describe this bug. We can describe how to reproduce the crash, and we have a call stack that shows where the crash is happening. So if all we care about is reporting this crash to somebody else on our team, we've got all we need. We can let them know what happened to lead to the crash, and we can give them the call stack. Ideally, we can provide them with a complete log file as well. And an important PSA, you can copy and paste the call stack as text. You can send log files as attachments. Please don't be the guy that sends pictures of text. Thank you. Now, if we're responsible for investigating the problem, we can use this information to look into why the bug is happening. If we follow the repro steps, we should get the same error, generally with the same call stack. Based on the call stack, we can find the point in the codebase where the crash occurs. If we want to see more information about the state of the program, we can attach a debugger before we reproduce the crash. This bug turns out to be pretty simple. When we click the eject button, the editor runs a function that switches us out of play an editor and returns control to the editor viewport. If we're currently looking through a local player's point of view, then this function updates the editor viewport to match that location and rotation, so that there's no jarring change in perspective for the user. The null pointer dereference happens here when we try to access the player controller in order to get its point of view. Generally speaking, a crash happens because code was written with a particular set of assumptions in mind, but it ended up running under conditions that violate those assumptions. In this case, this function checks whether the PIE session has a valid local player, but then it uses the associated player controller without checking whether it's valid. It's making the assumption that when this function is called with a valid local player, then it'll always have a valid player controller. If you want to avoid bugs in the first place, it's a good idea to be deliberate about the assumptions your code is making. If we expect that this is a fair assumption to make, that is, that the player controller should always be valid here, then we can make that explicit by adding an assert. When somebody else looks at this code, this assert makes it clear to them that this assumption is a conscious choice. And if the assumption turns out to be wrong, we'll crash with an assertion error that clearly identifies the problem. In a case like this, though, it's probably more likely that we'd just want to not make that assumption, in which case we'd want to make our condition a little more strict. So if this was code that we were maintaining ourselves, then we could test this fix to make sure it solves the problem without introducing any new issues, and then we'd be done. However, this seems like a legitimate engine bug, and we're currently just using a launcher build of the engine. We're not building the engine from source. So if we want this problem to be fixed, the easiest way to help that happen is to submit a bug report. Before we do that, there are a couple of extra things we should do. First, we want to be sure that the bug isn't already a known issue. To do that, we can search through the official issue tracker and the Answer Hub site to see if there are any similar issues. For this crash, I looked for references to the function where the crash occurs, as well as the word eject, and I didn't find any existing issues that describe a similar problem. We also want to verify that this is actually a legitimate engine bug by ruling out the possibility that our project might be doing something weird to cause the problem. This crash is pretty cut and dried, but it's no trouble to just make a brand new project and verify that the problem still occurs. Some bugs are more complicated, and they might only occur based on how our project's code or assets are set up. In those cases, creating a clean test project is essential, since it lets us isolate the conditions that lead to the crash outside of the complexities of a real project. We don't want to submit bug reports that just create a bunch of useless noise, so this level of due diligence is important. Once we've verified that our bug is valid and that it's not a known issue, we want to put some effort into filing a clear report with all the necessary information. So we can copy the call stack, prepare our repro steps, and write up any notes. I find it helpful to write up a clear description of what I think is happening. This isn't really for the benefit of the reader, I've just found it's a good way to test my understanding of the problem and discover any gaps in my reasoning. Then we can fill out a bug report, making sure we're entering all the required information as clearly and precisely as possible. Separately, it's also a decent idea to send a crash report from the editor. This will just submit an automated report that includes the call stack, as well as a log and many-dump file. Once our bug report is confirmed, that's it. If QA is able to reproduce it, they'll create an issue to track the problem. From here, it might be fixed, it might be piled onto the backlog as a low-priority issue, or it might be ruled not a bug. Unless we're paying for support as licensees, we shouldn't submit a bug report with the expectation that we're entitled to a fix. If it's a severe problem or a really simple thing to correct, it'll probably get fixed for the next engine release. But bugs have to be triaged, and that decision is out of our hands. In this case, it seems like the fix was pretty easy because the issue was resolved within a day. The fix was submitted to Epic's Perforce depot at this change list number, so we can watch for that change to be integrated into the GitHub repo. And this fix has been tagged for inclusion in the next engine release. So we started out with a frustrating crash that interrupted our work. It took a little bit of time to collect all the necessary information and convey it to the right people, but now the problem is fixed. I hope this video has helped you understand how to deal with bugs. And look, as you go through life, you'll experience suffering and loss. Bad things will happen. And some people will try and tell you, everything happens for a reason. Well, those people are full of shit. But you can take some solace in the fact that when it comes to software bugs, everything really does happen for a reason. Sure, it's frustrating to deal with crashes when you're trying to get work done, but for every crash, there's a reason why. And if you figure out that reason, well, you're halfway to fixing the bug. So whether you're the programmer who's submitting the fix, or just a frustrated artist making a bug report, or a QA analyst working to fill in the missing pieces of the puzzle, you're doing meaningful work to make the project less buggy. And speaking for myself, that work is appreciated. So, just to review, if you're a non-programmer dealing with a bug, look for the call stack, try and describe how to reproduce the issue, and send log files and text. Don't send images of text. If you're a programmer, start from the call stack, use a debugger, look at the code, try and figure out what assumption it's making that isn't being met, and ask yourself, is it wrong to be making that assumption, or is the program doing something weird to violate that assumption? And if you suspect an engine bug, rule out project-specific issues, look for existing issues, and write good bug reports. That's it. And I'm trying to make more of these, so if there's anything you'd like to see me cover, feel free to leave a comment, and follow me on Twitter if you want. Thanks for watching.